Good morning, everyone. Scano Swagwego. Andetun Inisot Nikyaso, Ganyatet Nongeshautet, Ganyat Kyono Niwakwenzodet. Hello, my name is Sarah General. I work at Six Nations Polytechnic, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you to SNP's lecture series, Conversations in Cultural Fluency. We're also very happy to be able to live stream this event, so hello also to our online viewers, and thank you for taking the time to join us. As a quick note, we will be recording this event, so it will be available for viewing in the future, and it will be on our website, www.sixnationspolytechnic.com. So this lecture is the first in a series of five events. Our vision for this lecture series was to be able to have a conversation with Indigenous researchers, scholars, knowledge guardians, and community members about topics that were important to us and that we had a shared interest in learning more about. There are a lot of really amazing topics that we want to explore in the future, but for this series, we're going to be focusing on five. Today's event is about the creation story. Our next event will be Ecological Knowledge of the Dish with One Spoon, followed by Three Sisters Sustainability, Good Mindedness with the Great Law of Peace, and Navigating the Two Row Wampum. So today we're very fortunate to have two scholars join us who have dedicated much of their research to the area of the creation story, Drs. Kevin White and Amber Adams. The format of this morning's event will be to hear from each of our two presenters, followed by a question and answer period with Rick Hill, the Senior Project Coordinator for the Deyohahá Indigenous Knowledge Centre. We plan to finish up by noon, so just to give you an idea of the time frames. And I think that's everything. So Niawa, I hope you enjoyed the lectures. And I'm just going to invite Rick up to tell you a little bit more and introduce our guest. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, try it, Askenehe. I'm a member of the Beaver Clan of the Tuscarora Nation and a coordinator at Deyohahá at the Six Nations Polytechnic. We crafted this idea of cultural fluency as a way to share a conversation about the ability to understand the cultural foundations, the intent of our culture, as expressed through our various stories and the traditions that we have. It's really our way of trying to find out what was the thinking of our ancestors and how did they determine their way of life. But cultural fluency is always about how we gain this understanding and then put it into action in our lives. So we are very concerned about linguistic fluency in our communities. At the same time, we have to be concerned about how well do we understand the culture that the language represents. So to get our own minds in lined up with that of our ancestors, we thought we'd have these discussions. Not that one conversation will do it, but to launch that. We're producing a series of webinars that are also available through the Six Nations Polytechnic website. It's a kind of a preliminary discussion to these conversations, so we'd advise that you take a look at that, give you an overview of the bigger picture of the story and its teachings. And we're hearing more and learn about the creation story, and with our scholars that are joining us, this has been a very intense discussion among our people, actually for over 100 years. It's been kind of recently revived in the last 40 years or so, and so we have I would have to take a second look, a third look back at what this story means. And why should we care about this old story? Well, I'm finding that in my life, and I think in the lives of our people, much is explained to the creation story. Much of what we do, that's where the origins are. So getting to understand that is important, but also getting to realize that there are many versions of the creation story, and you don't want to get too focused on one particular aspect of it, because our communities have a very diverse opinion about what this story is. So what we're going to do is have the speakers come up. They're going to introduce themselves, talk a little bit about their work, and after they present, we'll have some time for questions and answers from all of us as we continue this discussion. And then our goal here is not to focus on the differences in the stories, but what are the big underlying values, traditions, beliefs, and practices that should unite us together, and then how do we use these things hopefully to build a better life for all of us. So I'd like to begin by introducing Kevin White. I've actually known Kevin for quite some time. We all worked together at the University of Buffalo, where I taught in Native American Studies for many years. And in many ways, he picked up on the legacy created by John Mohawk. John, a Seneca scholar, is one of the few who actually wrote a version of the creation story, or wrote his interpretation of that creation story. So I'm going to invite Kevin to come up here and explain a little bit more about himself and the work that he's doing, and then we'll have a discussion with Kevin. Kevin, thank you.
Sago, and thank you for inviting me, and I'm happy to be here. I think I've been wrestling with this for quite some time now. My original work and research was finished in about 2007. And there are just so many layers to peel back on the story that it just doesn't really stop for me. I've been attending conferences and presenting papers and going to communities and talking about this. And it's simply too big for one person or one community or one group of people to just completely understand and wrestle with. Next slide, please. So I'm going to start with kind of some of where my basic research began with this work. John Mohawk had actually focused on John Arthur Gibson's work with J.M.B. Hewitt, known as usually part two of the Iroquois cosmology. So I kind of, John steered me towards part one, which is a kind of a little bit of a lesser known and harder to find piece of research. And so I began to analyze it, and it's one of the few versions that, for me, where Gibson's work focuses with Hewitt on an Onondaga language version. Part one focuses on an Onondaga language version, a Seneca version, and a Mohawk version. And so I kind of extracted out some of these points of contemplation for myself and how we kind of think about it. And I modeled it off of William Fenton's kind of plot points. He and Arthur Parker articulate these certain select plot points that range from about 9 to 23 that Fenton argued is all you need to understand the creation story. And I disagreed with that, and I still disagree with it, because the story itself has a certain flow to it that begins to make sense about how I think, and I think Amber's going to explain this a little bit further, how the natural world evolved. And I mean, in most places today, the story often starts with Sky Woman falling or Sky Woman's exit. And I began with a very basic question for myself, because I learned it as a kid that Sky Woman got too close to the edge and slipped through the hole. That was the version I had learned growing up in Rochester. And then there were all these other versions that articulate this kind of almost violent ejection from Sky World. And so I really wanted to understand that. So I began to use these key points of analysis where I look at the speakers or holders of tradition, and I borrowed that term from John because he writes about that in his 2005 book, that these are the speakers and they hold the tradition together, and they're responsible for carrying the story forward. And I think one of the single biggest questions I often get asked at discussions about creation story is, in fact, well, which version is correct? And it sounds like a kind of a political answer, but I say all of them and none of them because of the next points. For me, each nation seems to need to hear different things out of the story itself. And I think this is where part one really comes into play for me. Because in the Onondaga version that Hewitt works on with Chief John Buck, he really kind of articulates a great number of people that are present at creation throughout the story of creation. So it's almost like a who's list of that's there at creation. Where when you go to Seth Newhouse's version and the work he does with Hewitt, it actually becomes this kind of almost action story. It's not so much who's present as much as what's happening and why it's happening. And they're fairly similar. And I used to kind of love to pick on John a little bit because the Seneca version just seemed like an anomaly because it just seems so very different than the Onondaga and Mohawk versions that Hewitt's writing about in part one. But they're really not. I think this is where I began to develop this kind of framework of thinking that it's the articulation based on each community's or nation's needs, because there's a way it's articulated. So that's why I've intended nation up there. And I think when we step back and like kind of look at the big picture and look at the number of versions that exist that are published, and I will be the first to admit that I've only worked with the published versions, those that are already out there published. I haven't yet gotten into some of the archival research to see at the look at and examine the unpublished version. So I'm dealing primarily with the published versions. And they start to begin to reveal different patterns through the different eras of why things change. Well, I started to ponder why things change or why things evolve. This is where I get in one of those big tension moments with Fenton, because Fenton wants to articulate that any change is bad. And I think we as communities and as nations and people have fallen into that trap too, which is that question of authenticity. Why do we want one authentic version when they reflect different things? So era comes into play for me. And I think the last part of this really fixates on who gathered the story, who procured it, who translated and articulated it and wrote about it. And hearing the story spoken versus reading the story are two different mindsets. Because I ask my students this all the time. If you're hearing something, you're much more likely to be engaged, especially if it's an engaging speaker. And I can't think our speakers were not engaging people. And in that context, think about how we read a book today. Most people do it in isolation, alone, and then there's nobody to really talk about it with right then and there. And for a long time, I was beginning to feel like John and I were one, you know, few people that were really talking about all this work. And so it's been tremendous for me to see the growth of this articulation of creation story and all the frameworks. So you see that the next portions are kind of divided up into segments. And these are what I kind of consider the mini epic narratives of creation based on part one. So we have this kind of description of Sky World, and we have the first death and the first, well, not the first marriage, but the marriage that is described in Sky World. We talk about the, you know, celestial tree, the medicine, and dream guessing. All of this is articulated in all three versions of Hewitt's part one cosmology that he did with Chief John Buck, Chief John Armstrong, and Seth Newhouse. And then we kind of fall into this kind of two-world scenario where there's the Sky World, but there's also this middle world in the floor of Sky World that's articulated. And compared to most of the other published versions, it's only really articulated in the Hewitt part one stuff and the Hewitt part two stuff. And so then we begin to see this transition of Sky Woman coming down. And we know the story from that point forward, usually even to this day. But the real question for me became one of those simple ones. Well, did she fall or was she pushed? And there's a new way of thinking about it today, that she was articulating the pathway by which humans were to be born. Because humans aren't a factor yet. Humans don't exist. And this becomes a big thing. And this is where it's fascinating for me to go back to some of the old stuff that's published that Hewitt wrote in the language. Because when we really talk about them, Fenton and a lot of the other academics refer to them as human-like or human and equating them the same. But in the language articulation, they're always translated as more powerful than human. And I think Hewitt was a very, very fixated on word and very focused on the word choice that he used. And so I think this is a big thing we have to wrestle with as modern people. So then we kind of look at the forces of the natural world below and the gifts that are coming from above, which is linking the sky world and this water-covered world. And then in some versions, Sky Woman gives birth to her daughter in Sky World and is made to bundle her to her back for the fall or the exit. In other versions, she's just pregnant and then gives birth for the first time. And I kind of think, I tend to fall in that camp that looks at Sky Woman's daughter being kind of bundled back to herself and then giving birth again on Turtle's back, because this becomes a prominent thing. And I'm wrestling with this kind of articulation right now about whether or not this consensus model that we find in the Great Law is also present in creation, because all the animals of the water-covered world meet together to determine how they're going to aid this woman who's falling, who's bringing light with her, and as we know, who is bringing other things from Skyward, like seeds and mortar and pestle and corn and beaver's tail. And then we have the eventual marriage of Sky Woman's daughter, and the role of Sky Woman changes again to grandmother this time. So, and of course, the twins represent the creation of this world and the competition that we all kind of know the basics of the story with. And it's really articulated very differently in each version, and that's where I kind of begin to have some unique, interesting interpretations with that I love to wrestle with. So we begin to see food-created creatures, light and dark. We talk about the faces, and finally, towards the end of the story, humans are created. And then we have the great gamble for the world between the twins. And for me, this is where I articulate towards the end that this becomes the kind of final set of instructions. We're introduced to a period of time where humans forget their role in the natural world. And they have to be kind of retaught and re-educated about what their roles and responsibilities to the natural world are, because we're the benefactors, as John Mohawk would say, of this kind of great, bountiful world that all we have to really do is give acknowledgments and greetings and thanks to, because it was all put here. And contrasted to Western theology for me, humans are at the weakest in creation, and we need the most assistance and reminder of what we need to do and how we need to live in sync with the natural world, thus explaining our relationship to the natural world. Next slide, please. So in this list here, and I'm not going to read them all to you, but these are all of the published versions that I've encountered since 2007 and through today's discussion. You have Hewitt's work with, known as Part 1, that's published in 1903 with Chief John Buck, Chief John Armstrong, and Seth Newhouse, and then you have Part 2 with Chief John Arthur Gibson that's published in 1928. John Mohawk's notable work is 1994 with his dissertation and 2005. The early ones through 1816, I take exception to the 1630 pieces, which most academics refer to as the first accountings of creation story. They are actually Huron in nature, and they're gathered by the Jesuits, and the easiest, simplest way to explain what the Jesuits were doing, they weren't looking to record the story. They were looking to give a movie review of it. They were given a synopsis of it and commenting on about how foolish these Indians are that they say God has a father or a brother and a mother. So they completely missed the point of the story. It isn't until we get to Cusick's version and Schoolcraft's version and the ones through the 1800s and through Parker in 1922, Arthur C. Parker, that we really begin to see versions of the creation story accounted for. But we also see other anomalies in there, like corn soup being made with beef tips as a recipe of how to make corn soup, which is tied into a rendering of the creation story in some of Parker's work. And then we get into some of the early 2000 stuff and the Oneida stuff, the Elman, Antone, Dean, Day, Wonderly. Those are all kind of Oneida versions, and they have a different feel to them in some ways, which is kind of fun to look at because there's this tension that Wonderly is exploring about, are the twins actually representative of the shift from a hunting-gathering society to an agricultural society? I don't fully buy that argument, but we can definitely have some discussion centered around it. And then we start with my dissertation, Horne Miller's dissertation. Brian Rice has produced a book as of 2010, and Amber's dissertation. And I've got two things that I'm going to wrap up with this part on really quickly, which is the most promoted version, both in the academic world and largely understood in the literary and ethnography studies, is William Fenton's 1962 version, where he kind of takes and appropriates the story and says, this is how you need to interpret it, and nobody bothers to question him anymore. I'm working on an article right now from 16 to 78 that looks at a LaSalle version that's a Seneca version that almost identically matches Armstrong's work in 1903. And it's really, for me, going to cement our argument of how stable our oral history actually is. Because that's the one critique we always get in the academic world. We can't rely on oral history. Next slide, please. So one of my newest things has been kind of measuring with or thinking about this kind of concept of good mind and healthy mind and what that really means. We all use the term good mind, but using Hewitt's articulation, it's actually healthy mind in one of the language translations. And so a good mind might be best understood to be a healthy mind that is free from hunger, fear, unrest, anxiety, apprehension, longing, and jealousy, greed, and can perhaps be the most profound realization that one can exist isolated alone, but is it healthy to do so? We know that humans are social people, so we need each other. We need things to bounce off one another, to have conversations, and this is where I kind of harken back to what Tayage Alfred says, that one of our greatest pastimes was debate. We try to convince each other that our interpretation or version or understanding was the most correct, but it wasn't done to be authoritative. It was done to have discussions. So these points of discussions are always important to me, that's why I love being here today. And then this article, Rousing Curiosity in Hewitt's Cosmology, is an article that came out, I think, last fall. Frameworks of a healthy and unhealthy-minded thinking and actions are layered throughout the narrative of creation. Has our early models of the consensus decision-making process that Haudenosaunee are noted for in the academic literature. And I'm really starting to wrestle with this notion that the twins don't only represent all the aspects of things they created, they also represent a factor of choice for me. We can clearly see Creator looks at everything that's coming after him. He's creating the entire world for others. Where Flint seems almost primarily concerned with only his immediate needs and his desires. So for me, it's the choice between serving others or serving self. But there's always ways to come back from unhealthy thinking. It's a change of mind, because we have to admit as humans there are days where we have bad days. But does that always carry over going forward? I'm going to look at the last slide now. And I ended my dissertation with this. And orality for me is this very powerful thing, because I'm always struck by the tension between written word and how we remember things through our own memory and how it's characterized in oral history. And unfortunately, the academic world treats anything that Native people do as one thing. Storytelling is the same as oral history, is the same as diplomacy, is the same as a great speaker. It's not. And that's why I use this term orality. So this is how I understand in the intersection of orality, memory, and culture. At the convergence of sound, listening, and thought, orality is produced. Orality gives birth to the word. Word gives birth to meaning. Meaning begets language. Language evolves into story. Story morphs into history. History becomes memory. Memory educates thought. Thought shapes orality. Orality shapes origin stories. So going through that kind of way of thinking, this is why we're still wrestling with the story. And I've been told that it's a political answer to say that all the versions are correct and none of them are correct. And that is my position, but it's because it's orality based. Each generation is supposed to wrestle with the meanings and the interpretations of these stories. And then each generation is to bundle that all up and pass it forward to the next generation. The one thing that academics have never really delved that far into is the metaphor, the analogy. They've taken it literally, you know, and that's the flaw in it. So I think with that, that's my portion of it for right now.
We want to talk a little bit about some of the things you encountered. Could you talk a little bit about what themes or topics came up when you're looking at the creation story that you're still kind of confounded by? What did you have the most difficulty with?
That wrestling with the notion of the healthy mind and the unhealthy mind, because it's Latin throughout the story. And there are examples of thinking, for example, with Creator, where he kind of, both he and Flint are mistreating parts of the natural world. And so the natural world, in one of the versions, conspires against both twins, but he decides to stay in and send Flint out. And so they kill Flint, and because of his mourning and his grief, and thus his change from kind of a unhealthy mind, it becomes this dynamic of, well, how do we resolve this situation? So there, and for me, that's one of those, again, underscoring one of the core values of Haudenosaunee thinking of reciprocity and balance within the world. And so the creator and the animals come together and figure out how to solve this, and then they kind of bring Flint back. And there, you know, there's other notions of it for Flint's side too. For example, when he not only kills his mother in birth, but then in a couple of the versions he destroys where she's been laid to rest, but the story hints at that she's actually coming back to life as well. So I think the core values that we would all understand, reciprocity, good mind or healthy-minded thinking, and then following the kind of Thanksgiving address through, not just as a way of giving greetings and thanks, you know, as part of events that we're all gathered at, but as a way of approaching life, you know, that it's part of our, you know, notion of thinking that we have to do this when we wake up in the morning and when we, you know, go to rest at night, because we don't know what the numbers of days we have left on this planet are. And I think so. And I'm always struck by that notion of always coming back. We can make poor choices, but we can come back from it and rebuild relationships and rebuild community and be of a healthy mind and a healthy community.
You know, that's a good point. You could say that regeneration and transformation are themes throughout the creation story. This world was created as a place of constant regeneration, and that this transformation of the individual, because in many ways I think the Sky Woman and then Flint both kind of transform their behaviors to a certain degree to allow humans to exist. What are some of the other underlying values you've uncovered in the creation story?
The underlying values, I think, for a lot of this, it's just the sheer differences in some ways that kind of fascinate. But the values are are always present, you know, and they're the ones that we know, you know. I think I've heard Chief Tom Porter say this, that there's, you know, when we need to rethink things, we need to go back to the beginning of our origins, our creation, and then go to great law, and then move on to other values and systems. And I think the values I see in Gaiwio and even great law are, there's aspects of it that are in creation, you know, from, you know, arriving at consensus. And I think consensus doesn't mean unanimity. And I think that's where a point where sometimes we have communities has gotten stuck too, is that it must mean everybody has to agree. I think the true meaning of consensus and our way of thinking is that everybody has had their say and their voice, and everybody feels value and heard, but that doesn't mean it's the best course of action for the community or for the group. But we can agree to abide by this decision because it's, you know, we've talked it out. And I think there's hints of that in you know, creation, because, like, for example, all the animals that are in this water-covered world don't immediately consult with Turtle. In fact, he's the last that's consulted with, and he's the only one that can bear the weight of the world. You know, and he has to agree to it. They can't voluntold him to do it. You know, he agrees to it through consensus. And, you know, it's the reciprocities in there, the reciprocal relationships. And I think this notion of evolution of thinking and the natural world. And I find myself, you know, because I live in Oswego, which is snowy and cold and right on the lake. And I try to imagine, I find myself thinking more often than not when I'm sitting there on the lakeside on campus, exactly that kind of world thinking in terms of creation story, that, you know, it's just so powerful to sit there and watch. Sometimes the lake is calm, so, like I'm sure the water-covered world was. Other times it's choppy. And, the, you know, and then if you move back slowly from the lake, and I think Amber's going to talk more about this, you begin to see the evolution of life. And, I mean, it's... I think there's a lot of, I mean, there's just still so much to unpack. And I made a little boo-boo recently when I said, well, the evolution of the twins and their names changing and their roles changing, well, that really wasn't the case. It was Sky Woman that goes through all of these evolutions of names and roles and responsibilities. I mean, first she's Sky Woman, then she becomes mother again, then she becomes grandmother. And, you know, I think we can, as communities, go back and really talk about what these different roles mean and why these shifts happen and what our responsibilities are when we're in those kind of roles.
Another question I know John wrestled with is, how much did Hewitt's own personality and worldview and his Christian values influence how this story was finally published? How have you dealt with that?
I know there's, I won't say he's perfect in any, in necessarily any of his articulation, but I think he was... And that's where I spent a lot of time with part one, where I really got into his, where he translates the language or writes out the language and then does a literal English translation word for word, not the narrative that he does on top. And I think the part that he does on top of the page, in the top third of the page in these books, that isn't aimed at us. That's not for our own communities. That's not for our own evocation or thought. That's for a Western readership, because I think Hewitt was trying to articulate the huge intellectual capacity that's contained in the narratives themselves and the thinking that's behind it to a Western readership. That was his primary audience. And John was always articulating that to me. He goes, you gotta have to know your audience. He goes, who are you writing for? Why are you writing for them? And what are you hoping they're gonna understand from this piece of writing? I think the treasure trove for us as researchers and for myself is the language stuff. And it may not be perfectly articulated, but I think there's, you know, I think for me, like, healthy mind versus good mind in literal English, you know, literal translation, let's flesh that out some more. I mean, healthy mind doesn't just talk about a healthy mind or intellect. It talks about, an emotional well-being, a physical well-being, what we put into our systems for food and how we, nurture ourselves and find nutrition. I think that's all part and parcel of it, you know. And so healthy mind has a huge different framework for me than good mind. I'm not saying good mind is bad or inadequate. It's just a different way of thinking about it.
Well, you know, that's a really good point, too, because and you're talking about the connection to the great law. So later, when the peacemaker comes and trying to restore this good, healthy mind, it really is a reference back to the Creator's mind, and that a healthy mind, thinking well, will always gravitate towards peace. And you could say that was part of the original instructions that our people were given, that this is the way we should. In many ways, the creation story is about that, coming to peace. How do we resolve this difference in family and with the environment, you could say.
Right, and I think the other big underscoring point for me is that it's the connection to the natural world, that we have to maintain our connection to the natural world and understanding of it. And I think the only way I can articulate that is for myself, that I can, you know, that's part of the reason I always keep my dogs around, because dogs, for me, reflect my attitude back at me. Like, if I'm grumpy and cranky, they want anything to do with me. They'll go hide out in another room and hang out for the night. But I can also look around at the natural world and see the same thing. I used to do this all the time at Ganondagan, where if I was in a healthy mindset, I was eating well, getting enough sleep, and generally contented, I could get from me to you away from a deer. But if I was cranky and grumpy, boy, you could just not hear anything, not even hear the crickets or the bugs. Because I used to play with that sometimes. I'd go out and sit there and still myself again, and then everything would slowly come back to life. Then I'd make a movement because I was still cranky, and everything would go silent again. So the natural world is kind of a reflection back at us. I think it's our mirror of how we're centered or not centered. And I think it also provides a model of how we get back into being in that centered place.
Amber, did you have a question for Kevin?
A picky technical one. Okay. No. Just in terms of linguistics and language, where do you find healthy and unhealthy? Or don't you? Or you? It's just your interpretation. Because I've looked for anything, skanahadye, anything like that, and I can't find it.
I have to get back into the actual part one texts, and because I started looking for it the other night, because I thought that was one of the translations I had pulled out, like I did with some of the names of people in Buck's version, but I couldn't find it myself in my own work. But I know it's somewhere in there, and it might even be in Gibson's work, I'm not sure. And then it could be just because I've been wrestling with this, it might have been something I came up with out of thin air.
That's all.
Well, if Hewitt could do it, you could do it as well. The other thing about dogs, it's good to have them around in case you ever get hungry. But unfortunately, the creation story really doesn't talk about the origin of dogs or the creation of dogs. There's some dogs in the sky world, right? But there's no mention really in the story. Or have you found any?
No, there's no mention of them on Turtle's back. They are mentioned in Sky World before her exit. Interesting enough, and this is the one thing I've never reconciled fully, is that some of the suitors that come after Sky Woman before she finds the guardian of the tree are the exact same suitors that come after her daughter on Turtle's back. And there's no explanation as to why or how they came down to this world. Because the ones that are described in the water-covered world are usually beaver, muskrat, turtle. They even mention fish like largemouth bass and pike. Loon and blue heron and of course geese, but there's no mention of how, and I think that's another part. I think there's a part in before the exit that takes place where the guardian of the tree's mind is turned unhealthy, and we see the kind of ramifications of, because for me the research was consistent, at least in my dissertation, that shows until about 1960 it's always a forceful, almost violent exit of Sky Woman. The guardian of the tree literally kind of forces her out of Sky World violently. And I've never been able to account for the change of why the shift after 1960 to all of a sudden she's the daughter and then she slips through the hole. But I mean, again, that shows for me evolution of thought or thinking or conversations within communities, because I'd say argue somewhere around the late 80s, early 90s, it becomes that she purposely jumps through based on some communities' interpretations to kind of talk about birth. That's a conversation the twins also have, at least in part one, of how humans will be born. So they're already thinking about that down the road. But I think that kind of unhealthy mind, that's why I've really wrestled with this unhealthy mind, and I go back to that part where it talks about the any one of those things, grief for an extended period of time, which is why I think condolence is so important, is because grief can unsettle our mind and make it unhealthy in a long run. And there's always mechanisms to kind of either for an individual to start to try to right themselves, but an individual can't always do it, so they need the community or family or kin to also do that with them.
Yes, and if you look at the creation story then, is this reconciliation of the mind, both in the sky world, in the sky woman's mind itself. It is very interesting. But I also see a little bit of male bias in the story.
Oh yeah.
It starts early. It's the partner will say to the sky woman that kind of sends her on her journey. She's got to confront this old man who's guarding the tree, and then he sends her on the next bit of her journey. And when she gets down here, it's her grandson who transforms her mind, because in the beginning she kind of goes against him. Mm-hmm. So I often wondered about that. Was that because men writing the story, or was this the actual story, or what does that teach us about male and female relationships in the world?
Well, I think that's a very big and deep conversation we have to have, because most of the informants in all of those versions that are published are actually male. And for a matrilineal and matrifocal society, women's voices are often absent. And I think that's, again, where we have the creator kind of also has that change of mind. Because, I mean, by any stretch of the imagination, we can argue that he was within his right to kind of walk away from his brother and grandmother because they've treated him so horribly, but he doesn't. He helps kind of right their mind again and get them as healthy as they can be or fully healthy, and because they have roles and responsibilities to the natural world and to humans, because that's what he's always thinking about, is the humans that are coming here to dwell. And in terms of the male articulation, I think that's an interesting question that we really do have to have a dialogue about as communities and as researchers, is because it is heavily dominated by male voice and hardly any female voice.
John Mohawk used to raise another issue too about sometimes our people were enthusiastic in trying to apply the teachings of the creation story, and he says we have to remember sky world beings aren't human, and what happens up there and their abilities to things they do are different than down here. But one thing that's intrigued me, if you look at Newhouse's version in the Mohawk that he wrote it in, he's talking about a young couple up there in the sky world being protected or sheltered. And in his Mohawk world, he translated it to mean they were virgins. But then when Hewitt rewrites this and takes a look at that, he said they were down-fended. This concept of kids are protected and you put this this down around them so you're able to tell if anybody comes to visit them. It could be all metaphorical, but the whole idea of they're being secluded and protected, but my question is from what and for what purpose? Newhouse almost creates this idea that there's somehow they're special, noble people within the sky world beings. Was it just because they were so susceptible to what's going to happen later? How do you look at that?
I think I look at that in a kind of a similar vein that John did, that it was they were downfended because they were children of importance, or kind of children of destiny. They had important roles to play, and any alteration to, I think in bad thinking or unhealthy thinking around them could falter that and what their purpose was. And I think that ties into that we all have purposes, and some of, you know, they're not all the same. And so, you know, and I think that's part of, and I don't think Hewitt actually articulates that in the best way. And in fact, in some of the work I've in my dissertation, I actually kind of, because it is so complicated and confusing, I've streamed it down, slimmed it down quite a bit. And I think John did that too in his 2005 work. He doesn't really include it in the 2005 book.
And this is the one here that we're talking about that John Mohawk produced, the Iroquois creation story, John Arthur Gibson and J.M.B. Hewitt's A Myth of the Earth Grasper. John published that in 2005. Is that book still available somewhere?
It's very hard to get a hold of, and there's not that many copies of it anymore.
So I'm liable to put mine up for auction after the conversation today. All right, thank you very much for that. This is very good. Amber, if you wouldn't mind talking and sharing the nature of your research, we'd appreciate that.
Okay, you got it yet? There. Okay, Sego Zewa Guego, Wagwan Horado. Thank you very, very much for coming. It's wonderful that we have as many people here as we do. It kind of gets lonely, just me and Kevin and sometimes Rick talking about the creation story. I'd like to back us up just a little bit. Can everyone hear me okay, first of all, on this? Yeah. I don't like being tied to the podium. What Rick said initially about thinking about this story in terms of something not as an old story or something that it's good to know about because it's good to know our traditions, but as something that has immediate, direct relevance to our lives right now. That's how I think of it, and that's what's kept me studying it, reading it, rereading it for the last 10 years. And if I were to have another 10 years, and another 10 years, and another 10 years, I still wouldn't get to the end of what there is in this story to talk about. May I have the next slide, please? When we see images of, well, put Haudenosaunee Creation Story in Google, and this is what will come up. Images of Sky Woman and images of Sky Woman falling, this one moment in a very long, very complicated, multi-episodic story. And this is kind of what's captured in at least modern art forms. It's a painting by Ernie Smith from the 20s, I think. And then this is a painting by Shelley Nero fairly recently. If this is a story primarily about a woman who falls from the sky, this moment is the worst moment of her life. And this moment is somehow what we've chosen to use to represent her. What's happening in this moment? She's falling. And Kevin was right. Explanations of how she fell changes. They have changed. They vary from version to version. She was pushed. She slipped. She jumped. She was victimized by her husband. She was choosing to do something. No matter how you slice it, she's falling. Close your eyes and imagine the sensation of free fall. And it's dark and it's cold. And she has no idea what's waiting for her on the bottom. She doesn't know that there are birds that are going to break her fall. She doesn't know that turtle is going to come out of the water and support her. She doesn't know that muskrat is going to bring earth up for her to make a world out of. This is all a moment of total, complete, profound loss. She doesn't have anything except her life and the life of the child that she's carrying. And no matter what's coming, she's responsible for that life. It isn't as if she can just sort of give up on being alive and say, well, it's over for me. I've died. She has to keep going, and she's got nothing to go on with. How much more relevant to the experience of human beings, Haudenosaunee, Onkwehonwe, Haudenosaunee women. Total and complete loss, total and complete vulnerability. If I go to the next slide, please. But yet, when we see representations of her, look at her face. She looks calm, she looks peaceful. She's not struggling, she's not flailing. It's as if we imagine, because this story is old and because we've heard it before, that she knows what we know. And she doesn't in this moment. One of the tough things when we talk about kind of regeneration, remaking, retransformation, what has to come before re-anything is the loss of something else. And not only does she lose her family, her home, her, I guess for lack of a better word, culture, there's no other people around her to make that culture, there's nobody to support her in what she's doing, but she loses an entire world. And when she falls to Earth, she has to remake a world. Almost as a response to an emergency. Can I have a next slide, please? This is some traditional style beadwork. This is from a dress from Carolyn Parker. And these curves, these domes, kind of represent a little bit better than what the images, the paintings does, the whole process by which Sky Woman not only deals with this loss, but deals with the transformation of herself. And it's been said before that women aren't born, they're created. And this story is an incredible example of how that works. Like Kevin pointed out before, that the name of this woman changes as the story goes on. Can I have the next slide, please? she's really the only person in the story for whom that happens. She's the only three-dimensional character in the story, and what I mean by that is she's the only character that changes fundamentally from the beginning to the end. Even though the people in Sky World, they have an important part to play, the twins on Earth, they have a very important part to play, but those twins, they are who they are from in utero. They have an argument that doesn't change. They have the same damn argument for the entire story, and their positions don't change. They don't back off. They are not different people when that story's over. She is, absolutely. And I'm looking at the Gunyatgeha version, but this is obviously different than the Onondaga versions, the Seneca versions. That's it. There's no Cayuga version. There's no Oneida version. There's no Tuscarora version published that we know of. And just as an aside, one of the reasons that Kevin and I are kind of sounding like we're getting hung up on what's published is because there are so many different versions. You saw his list, that trying to deal with just those is tough enough. But trying to get a handle on what's out there buried in some archive somewhere in manuscript form, let alone what people just tell, it's impossible. It's impossible to know every version of the story because this story changes every time it's told. Okay. Anyway, back to her names. She starts out in the world above as Iaxa'a, as a little kid. We see her from almost infancy. Then she becomes Iaxazeha, a new body, a fresh body, a young woman, ready for marriage. This is the point at which, certainly in the Gibson Hewitt version, and also in the version that John Mohawk wrote based on that one, this is the point at which a representative of Elder Man, Hodahe, the guardian of the tree, comes to her mother and says, we're having some trouble guessing his dream. We want someone from your family to come and help, to come and participate in this dream guessing that's going on. And she says, well, I'll send my daughter. More or less, that's what she says. My Yeyatazeha. Right before she goes, she speaks to her, well, in some versions it's her father, and in some versions it's her maternal uncle, the first person to die in Sky World. He dies, but she still communicates with him through the rest of the story. She talks with him, and she tells him about what's going on, and he says, yes, I want you to go. I want you to go to this guardian of the tree. When you get there, tell him that your name is Awanha'i. And again, this is the Onondaga version. There are different ways of expressing this name, but what it means is mature flowers or mature blossoms. Tell him that's what you're called. Well, she becomes his partner, marries him, becomes pregnant. And the first time that she's called Yagungwe is on her way down as she's falling. It's pretty ironic that this word for woman is when she's suffered this devastating, cataclysmic loss. That's the first time we see that. On Earth, she's a mother, Gotnistanha. She's a grandmother to the twins, Rokstanha. And then eventually, in some versions, her head becomes the moon. Yunkisota Asuntaneka Galakwa. So there's this pretty incredible transformation. And she comes full circle at the end of the story. She goes back to the world above, where she was as a girl, and she's completed an entire life circle throughout this. Can I have the next slide, please? That name, Mature Blossoms, it's a pretty name, but it also refers to a very, very specific moment in the life cycle of a flowering plant. It's the point at which the flower is ready to be pollinated. It's the point at which the flower is ready to produce. So she is given this name right before she goes to get married, to become pregnant, and then eventually to fall the way that a fruit does when it's ready to leave its seed someplace for a new fruit to grow. She's given this name. It's not an accident. May I have the next one? And when she falls, she is pregnant. And I know Rick and Kevin have both talked a little bit about her falling through the floor of this world above as an act of birth. It is. But it's also an act of seeding. She's a seed. She's carrying a seed. She's also, and this is interesting, how many people have heard it said that when she's falling, she grabs the roots of this tree, this great tree, and she gets soil and she gets seed, and sometimes it's strawberry seed, sometimes it's oyankwa'onwe, tobacco seed, some bits of the root in there, and she carries that down with her. I know I've heard it. It's not in any of the versions, not that I've seen. But when she comes down, she's bringing the material that she needs for new life from one world into a place where there's no world yet. So next slide, please. Now, here's where it gets interesting, for me anyway. This flower, this seed, this being that's coming down, she's got no place to land. If this were a garden, there would be no soil in which this woman, this child, this world could grow. Conditions have to be right. How many people in here garden, keep a garden? Yeah, good. A few of you. Me, sometimes, when I can. It's flower pots this year. But there's, in ecology, in the study of ecology, there's what we call succession, serial succession. And basically, this says that when something has happened to devastate a place, a fire or a flood or a tornado, there's a sequence and an order to the way in which life comes back to that place. First, we start with bare rock, and then little mosses and small plants creep in, and then bigger annual plants and grasses and things like that. And then shrubs, and then pine trees, and then finally you get the climax community, which in this part of the world is Carolinian forest, hardwood forest. But you can see that as we go, there's more biodiversity, there's more soil, there's more life. And when the woman who falls from the sky falls, the only place that she has to land is turtle's back. And in terms of ecological succession, that's like bare rock. Can I have the next slide, please? As Kevin talked about a little bit, different versions are different lengths, different levels of detail. The very earliest versions are really, what'd you say, movie reviews? Yeah, he's right. The longest version, the most detailed that I've seen, is the version that was dictated by Scania Darlio, John Arthur Gibson, to J.N.B. Hewitt, who was a scholar, self-trained linguist from Tuscarora. This is, what would you say, about as long again as the other three that he took? Yeah, it's about three times as long as the next longest ones that we have, and it's about three times as detailed. One of the kinds of detail that he includes are an amazing amount of plant species. And these are a listing of just a few. And it's an incredible repository of information about medicine plants, food plants, the kind of plants that make the Haudenosaunee world. One of the interesting things about this creation story, as opposed to, let's say, for example, the Passamaquoddy story of creation. We have Chief Hugh Akaji here from the Passamaquoddy Nation today, and he can correct me here. But in other people's versions of their creation story, a lot of the time specific places will be referred to. There's the mountain where Glooskap pulled the whale out of the sea and fed all the people. Or there's the place where the Hopi emerged from the ground. etc. That's not so in the Haudenosaunee creation story. There's no point, at least not one that I've ever seen, where a specific place is referred to. But it's so specific, the description of what grows here and what lives here, that we really don't need it. This is a picture of our home. And it's not just what species appear, it's when they appear. So, in Sky World, we've got sugar maple, American chestnut, tulip tree, chokecherry. These are all species that are characteristic of a Carolinian forest. These are all the species of a climax community, a place that's undisturbed, a place that's developed over time, a place that's growing and flourishing. And then, Sky Woman falls. And the rest of the story describes the plants that emerge. First, we get smallish things, like the wild strawberry. We get the bacteria on Sky Woman's feet when she shuffle dances. That's another thing that doesn't make it into the written versions. When she's spreading the earth from Muskrat's paw around Turtle's back, she's not using her hands. She's using her feet. And this is, I don't know, you could maybe make a case for the reason that it's her feet instead of her hands or any other way she could spread things around, because she herself is a being that's full of microlife, and she's spreading that around as a way to begin to make the soil alive, begin to make it a place where seeds can grow, where things can grow. Because remember, at this point, she's still pregnant in all but a couple of the versions. She still needs to make a place where she can give birth, where her and her child can survive. And she's doing it, you know, with the generosity of the animals that are helping her, but she's still doing it on a pretty thin survival margin. So these are the plants that start to come up. As things develop, her child is born, the twins are born, they start to create things. We get sunflower, huckleberry, raspberry. These are plants that do really well in disturbance sites. How many people have ever been down to Allegheny and seen where a tornado has cut a path through the bush? Trees are sheared off branch by branch, but there'll be a big swath of huckleberries or blackberries. These are the things that come next in this successional ecology. Finally, toward the end of the story, we get trees that appear like the ones that are in Sky World, white pine. We get the three sisters, corn, beans, squash. We get an ecology that's a lot more like the one that was in Sky World, the one that that Sky Woman knew, that she remembered, and the one that she knew how to survive in, the one that she knew how to get food from. Can I have the next slide, please? So as the story progresses, she's in Sky World, and she falls on Turtle's back. That's kind of ground zero. And an ecology builds slowly, slowly. And these are the species that appear. And if you take a look at the next slide, please. It's also how her name changes. She's a child, she's a child, she's a woman when she falls, and as she goes on, as the ecology redevelops, she continues to develop. So the two are linked, the two are synchronous. There's the smaller circle of her own personal development as a being, as a Yagongwe, as a woman, inside the much bigger circle of how this ecology is developing or redeveloping on Earth after it's been lost for her when she left the world above. Can I have the next slide? And this is from Earth Grasper, the 2005 John Mohawk version. Now all the flowers of the tree which have illuminated this world for all time have become new. Those trees, that those flowers were dying, the tree was sick, and that's what precipitates this whole crisis in the world above. All things shall come into a constant state of unending transformation and retransformation. So this is how it's going to be on Earth. Kevin talked a little bit about what John used to say about the beings in the world above not being human beings. Well, the only real difference that I can spot is that they don't die. Life in the world above is static. There is no loss. And that's not the case on Earth. Retransformation does mean loss, but it also means constant renewal. And that's something that I've been still chewing on and still thinking about, a story of creation being so much a story about loss and how we deal with it. But I think that's important to understand kind of how things are the way they are here and what we end up having to do to deal with those things, because that loss has an effect on us. And it's something that's articulated, I think, more fully in the story of the Peacemaker's Journey and Garnanatsulagoa, the Great Law. We have a very structured, specific way of dealing with loss. In the creation story, we have a way of dealing with loss. It's just a lot less structured. And I think that what we have is a much more, I guess, a personal view of it when we see loss at work in Sky Woman than what we have in the story of the Peacemaker's Journey, which is dealing with individual loss, certainly, but it's the loss of people, it's the loss of nations, it's the loss of it's the loss of place on a bigger scale, but this is the loss of place on a very, very personal scale. So I think I'll leave it there for now and we'll do some questions, I hope.
Yeah, the question of dealing with loss, that's a good one, because I think that's one thing when I began to look at the creation story, just trying to wrestle with that myself and this idea of regeneration. But also tell you a secret. And I was involved in, we built the Native American Center for the Living Arts in Niagara Falls. It was designed in the shape of a turtle. And we started working on this in 1976. And part of my task was to go and gather the original story. What's the real creation story? So we went around and we talked to all kinds of people everywhere. And we kept running into a dead end. Even the wise longhouse leaders, they say, well, we don't know that story. We don't know anything about that. We never heard about Turtle Island. And it was one day I went to this teacher training and there was John Mohawk talking about this creation story. And I asked John, where'd you get that? And then John, in his usual devilish way, he just chuckled. He says, well, it's in the book. J.M.B. Hewitt wrote this. And then he told me about his adventure in learning. I'm talking to the old guys. Nearly all of the old longhouse people read all of these books like we have here. They read Hewitt's book. They read Parker's book. They read about this stuff because they were fascinated themselves. But it got me thinking of how old is our story and how well was it carried on. And when you think about it, we put so much faith that John Arthur Gibson or Seth Newhouse knew it so well that they could just sit there and roll it off their tongue. So I think we also have to accept the fact that there's some missing elements, there's some personal opinion, there's a whole lot of stuff in there, but there's all so much great stuff in there about how to live in this world. What other things do you see about healing in the creation story that you looked at?
Healing's not easy. I wish we had Chandra up here too. We were talking about this the other day. One of the big things, and this kind of feeds into what Kevin was talking about with healthy mind and unhealthy mind and what happens with the twins, is this constant argument over food. I mean, if you accept the idea that this is a new ecology and it's developing and, you know, everything isn't exactly in place yet, and Sky Woman is coming from a place where when you look at what's going on, when they get married, there's marriage bread. So it's corn and it's huckleberries and he's giving them venison. So this is all a diet very much like, you know, the traditional Haudenosaunee diet. After she falls, after she gives birth and she has these grandchildren, for the rest of the story, she's hungry. They're on the edge of starvation.
And there are a couple of times, and this especially comes out in the Gibson version, and then in John's version, where, you know, she's, what's the word, hangry. She's hungry and she's angry. And I mean, when we talk about healthy mind, unhealthy mind, well, we have to start with healthy body, unhealthy body, healthy diet, unhealthy diet. The episode where she, the Haudenosaunee-Indigenous, the right-handed twins roasting corn, and he's just come up with this corn. And he's roasting it. She can smell it. She remembers the smell. She wants some. She begs him for some. Just give me a kernel. Just give me a bite. And he won't. And she gets angry and she picks up ash and throws it on the corn and says, "That's it. You know, I don't know why you are so hell-bent on making these human beings that aren't even here happy. We're here now. We're your family. We need to eat." You know, and I totally sympathized with her when she did that. I mean, I know it's supposed to be evidence of, you know, her kind of, her mind being sickened by all this loss and all this grief. But I'm going to take a chapter out of your book and say that a big part of healing is being able to have that food security, nutritional security. I mean, that's what's got to happen before anything else happens, before there's any kind of discussion between the twins about, you know, how do we divide this world up? How do we do this? Before there's any kind of reconciliation within this woman's mind, that has to happen first. And it takes the whole rest of the story for it to happen, at least in the Gibson version.
You know, that's a good point, too, because later in the Great Law, we see, again, where food is really an essential element throughout the story. John Arthur Gibson wrote a little piece about the role of what he called the female chief, which was the clan mother. And what he said is that her primary function is to cook for her family. But what he explained is that her job is to make sure that people in her clan, particularly the chief and the title holders, are so well fed with this good nutrition that their mind will naturally then gravitate towards peace. Because what she said is, when people are satiated, when you're full, you're happy and more likely to be peaceful. So it's really kind of interesting when you see the premise, we can say in the creation story, restoring good-mindedness. It depends on this nutrition as well as resolving the grief that you're carrying. And then it later comes up in the Great Law. It makes for an interesting continuity between that all. So later in our future conversations, that's where we're going to focus on the dish with one spoon, a concept of sharing from nature, as well as this idea of the three sisters. I've often thought, and correct me if I'm mistaken, the creation story is also about making a family within the universe. They're all connected back to these sky beings there, right? So that we have the Mother Earth, and we have the three sisters born out of her body, just as the Creator was. We have the Grandmother Moon and the Elder Brother Sun. This is all this one big family that's still looking out after us. Is that what you discovered as well?
One big dysfunctional family, yes. Yeah.
Well, good. We're carrying on the tradition quite well.
We're very traditional. Yeah, of course. And I mean, one of the things that, it's easy to lose sight of the fact that what we have now, these, you know, these big versions that are written down in Onondaga and translated by Hewitt, or Mohawk and translated by Hewitt, is that most of the guys who were working with Hewitt at that time were, John Arthur Gibson, John Buck Sr., I don't think Armstrong was a chief, was he? Oh, was it? Okay. Well, most of them are chiefs, and most of them are, at that time, kind of the late 1880s, 1890s, they're up to 1924, they're under direct threat by the federal government, and they're scrambling around trying to find a way to justify the Haudenosaunee system of government. So they've got the Great Law on their minds, and it's, for me, it's a lot easier looking at the Gibson version of the creation story, to think of him thinking in terms of this being part one and the law is part two.
Oh, yeah.
Because, I mean, if you've got this very specific, very structured way of restoring peace to a grieving family, to a grieving nation, whatever,
well, the logical first step is figuring out how to do it in this small family. But when we look at it, and I mean, my take on it is maybe a little darker than yours, Kevin, but you know, we've got this immediate split when Sky Woman's daughter dies, and you know, the left-handed twin blames the right-handed one, and the grandmother, in most of the versions, this grandmother exposes this baby. She throws him away. She throws him into the bush to die. And that's some dysfunction. In a couple of the more recent versions I've seen, it's been kind of like a less harsh version of that. They sort of went their separate ways, but in the older stuff, it's very definite. She means for him to not exist anymore. So he grows up, he gets more independent, they both do. And he goes to Turtle Man. In the Gibson version, Turtle Man, kind of the earth itself, is his father, and he goes to see his father and says, you know, I'm not making it without the protection of my grandmother, without the protection of my family. I'm not gonna survive. And that's when he you know, talks to him, gives him the arrows, and he goes in and sees his father a few more times during at least that version of the story. But what you have really is Dawiskalon, the left-handed twin, kind of making some of the bad choices that he makes, partly out of still having the responsibility of caring for his grandmother, which his brother has walked away from, justifiably or no, he's walked away from it. You have no one teaching these boys how to be men. So there's this whole kind of child development part to it that I don't think that we've really talked about very much.
That's a little scary. I think what we'd like to do is open up the conversation here with our people in our audience. Kevin, if you could use this microphone. To repeat it for the microphone so we can all hear that. Does anybody have a question that they would like to ask of our two speakers? Or any comment about the creation story you might have without making a 45-minute soliloquy? What would you like to share? Yes. Yeah, that's a good point then. So the question is, seeing how there was a shift in how the story was told about how she came out of the sky world, what was going on politically, the kind of the social actions of the time that may have influenced our thinking towards that, and particularly then what kind of agency was being created among our people and ability to do these things that came out of that era, how would you respond to that?
I'm the woman, I'll start. I think there's kind of a middle ground in between. She was pushed, this is a person who has no control over her life at all, or she jumped, this is a person who has total control over her life. I'm a little bit, I find the jumping version a little bit problematic because she's not a lone agent. You know, she does have a family, there is a whole world that she's part of, so I mean, jumping is, would be, considering what she's jumping into, sort of tantamount to suicide. I like the Gibson version for a lot of reasons. One of them is that there's sort of a middle ground. There is some, not much, discussion between her and her husband about what needs to happen. At least that's how I read it. And it's, you know, they both have some grief over this parting that needs to take place in order to heal what's gone wrong in the sky world, because the sky world's ecology is failing too. This tree is dying, so something drastic has to happen. I think it's in, you know, when things sort of shifted, I think it speaks to a little bit of embarrassment maybe on the part of people who were sort of going back and, you know, if they were looking at these versions and saying, oh my God, you know, we're matrilocal, matrifocal, woman, 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 but in this, our creation story, this poor woman is being, you know, really, I hate the word victimized, but you know what I'm trying to say. She's not in control. So I think there was kind of maybe an urge to rehabilitate those parts of the story. I don't know.
Yeah, I would agree. I think that there's a lot of, I think that's the reason it sticks out to me, is that it's in the 60s and we're seeing a revitalization of culture and agency among our own people. It's a turbulent time internally in our communities. And I think as we continue to, I mean, however we look at it from, you know, the 1860s, 1870s forward, there's a disenfranchisement of Indigenous people and generations of thought that are being lost because of that disenfranchisement. And so I think there's some of this that is in there. We need to soften the stance a little bit. It doesn't seem right for a matrilineal or matrifocal society to have this almost violent ejection of Sky Woman. But I also think that we have to hearken back to, in some capacity, to that notion that while she looks like human or is described as like human, she's not human. She's a force of nature, a spiritual force of nature, or representative of those spiritual forces of nature, which is, you know, following that kind of ecological evolution that Amber just talked about. Let's face it, those kind of early primitive worlds were violent, and you know, the and I think that's why I kind of come back to this kind of healthy mind and unhealthy mind. And I think this is one point I was going to ask you if I had the chance, was, is there a parallel between how you articulated Sky Woman's roles and names changing? Is the same articulation contained in our Thanksgiving address? Because it follows a similar format from early, you know, think about the order in which we give thanks and greetings to everything in the natural world. There's a parallel there. And is there a reason that we're supposed to do this daily? In other words, when we wake up and take our first breath, and when we, before we retire, we give those same greetings again. Is that so? That's that constant reminder of how we reframe things. So I think, and I don't think it's bad or different that any generation wrestles with it differently. I think that's the beauty in the metaphor of bundling all this stuff together and passing it forward, because each generation has faced different things. And the outcomes, and, I mean, let's face it, in the 1920s, 30s, 40s, how many generations were proud to be Indian? And there's that resurgence in the 60s. It's grown exponentially now, I think. And, you know, so I think there's a lot of this in it. And I'm not necessarily always hung up on one authentic version or interpretation, because it's how we wrestle with it in each generation. So.
Interesting, because of wrestling with the same thing with the Great Law, where the grandmother tries to actually destroy the peacemaker as a baby three times. And I think what happened, there was a kind of reaction among our people, two reactions. One is those who were also raised as Christians saw some parallels to the story, and that was, she just reformatted Eve, being cast out of the Garden of Eden because she was sinful. And then this other kind of underlying thing is that, was she pregnant before she fell, and that there was this suspicion from the old man that it wasn't his child, all of which just causes this, the mind going out of whack. His mind going out of whack, even if it resulted then in this violent behavior. So when I tried to wrestle with this, it wasn't until I spoke to Huron Miller, who helped me understand that what he said is, the hole was there. He said, let's sit by this hole, and they hung their legs over the edge, and he says, we're going to have a meal. Let's eat a meal here. And then the old man's talking to her, Okay, now now your destiny is going to be fulfilled when you go down in here. She was a little reluctant, a little scared, but he was trying to reassure her. But as you can imagine, a lot of old guys tell you to take this big leap. So you kind of wait and say, I don't know. They said he put his hand on her back and said, okay, my dear, now it's time to go. And he doesn't cast her up, but he does give her a push to get her going. So I always prefer to take that. That's the scene that I think was more appropriate. But again, looking back, we're always re-editing things for our own taste, but we have to be a little careful of that when we employ modern-day sensibilities back on the story. However, the story is supposed to help us with our modern-day sensibilities, so we do have to wrestle with that issue. Are there any other questions out there? Yeah, so does the creation story offer us some teachings on how to deal with the ecological changes going on, particularly issues like climate change and things that we faced? Amber?
We're sitting on the edge of the hole in the old guy's hands on our back. No kidding. What an incredible tool to have right now in 2015. How many other stories are there out there that not only tell us what ecological loss looks like, what crisis looks like, what recovery looks like, and how we human beings deal with it. Because there's a range of ways that the people in this story, once they're on Earth, do deal with it. And, you know, everything from hoarding, like when the left-handed twin locks all the animals up in the cave and rolls the boulder ahead of the door and says, okay, now we have enough to eat, food security. What I was talking about before, throwing ash on the corn. Well, if you can't, or if I can't have it, nobody can have it. We're all set to do that again. And I know not just as Haudenosaunee, I mean, our food security has been threatened since 1492. I mean, this ecology has changed a lot, and it's waves and waves. It's still changing. The emerald ash borer, those damn stink bugs that are all over the place now. I mean, things are still entering. There are still waves of things that are changing this ecology, threatening this ecology. But the incredible thing about this story, and Rick brought up the age of it, and that's something I tried to look at a little bit too, is, you know, how old is it? Well, we've had a whole bunch of different waves of major, major climate change. We had one at the end of the last ice age. We had another one about 10,000 years ago when everything got drier and hotter, and that's when we first find people growing food, the Neolithic Revolution. So I think what we take away from this is not only the knowledge that, yes, the bottom can drop out from under the ecology that we know and understand and that we've built our economies on top of. But this is what it looks like on the human scale, the family scale, the individual scale when it does, because that is a loss and we're poised to face it again.
Another question? Caitlin. Yes, so the question is, what are responsibilities to the story and from the story? And what we should really be doing about all of this? In 24 words or less.
Okay. Talk about them, read them, tell them. I mean, there are some really beautiful versions of this that have been produced as children's books, and it's important that, you know, kids have access to this knowledge and look at it and think of it as a story. But it's also important that grown-ups think of it as a story. So being aware of it as something more than kind of the simplified version that probably most of us are most familiar with, and to talk about it. I mean, it's something that has helped me personally deal with loss. So I think that the stories are there to be loved and to be used. And I don't mean used like exploitatively, but used as something that we think about when we're trying to deal with each other, deal with life, deal with what's going on. So.
And I think I'm going to echo that and take it a little bit one step further. I don't speak the language. I know a few words here and there. But I think one of the more powerful moments I had was last summer when the Great Law Recital happened at Onondaga. I didn't hardly understand any of it, and I followed through the translations. But then we have to think about that kind of context. The importance is hearing the stories, and not just reading them, because that's done in isolation. You know, I curl up with a book all the time by myself. But then when something pops, I'm like, Copper, what do you think? And of course, he doesn't answer back. But then we have to look at the context in which these things happen. You hear the story, you know, till the sun hits the highest point. And then the way that was done, it was at the Great Law at Onondaga, was that people then went and had lunch and began to discuss it and the rest of the afternoon. And that's what is meant to have happened. And I think, you know, what I'm seeing happening with the Great Law Recitals, I hope at some point we begin to see with creation as well, because I think there's a difference in hearing it in the language than reading it in the language, and then, you know, having these great conversations and continuing in events like this where it's, you know, that kind of notion, because that's, you know, that's the wherewithal. That's how we begin to solve some of those future problems and recognize where the values are within the story itself. Because, you know, one person might have a different interpretation, and she was right to point out, I searched diligently last night looking for healthy mind unhealthy. I'm like, is that something that I just came out of nowhere with? And, you know, and I'm going to go back and now look through and see if I can actually find it in the Hewitt stuff. And I'm not sure I can, and it might have. But then how that became from a conversation at some point. And unfortunately for me, a lot of these versions have kind of merged into my head, and they've blended together. And so I don't always know which, okay, well, that might be Parker. Well, it could be Norton. It could be, you know. But I think that's why we have to have these discussions as communities, and especially with speakers that do remember the language. And I also think there's a point too where we have to articulate that these written works, how do we know Gibson, Buck, Armstrong, even Newhouse, weren't articulating a translation or a version to Hewitt because they knew his readership was going to be Western, not Haudenosaunee or not Ongwe. And so then that just speaks to the brilliance of those speakers and our speakers today that can operate on those multiple levels to me.
You know, I think the other part of what I see in this is that many parts of the story, there's specific instructions given to the humans that are created. And in one version of the story, the instructions are given, and then they kind of mess up, and creator comes back, straightens it out again, and he comes back again. And because the human mind is not the perfect mind. It's, we're always going to need instruction and inspiration and guidance to try to do the good thing. You could say the good thing, goodness, healthiness, peacefulness, it's all the same concept. But one part of one story, and I'm much like Kevin, I can't remember what I read, what I heard, and what I made up. Anyway, he tells the first humans that he makes, then, walk down this path. They could already see the footprints of the ancestors on the ground. He says, walk down this path and tell me what you see. Well, they go down the path. There's a big hole in the ground. There's a big pile of dirt next to it, and out of there growing the three sisters. So they go back and report to him. Now, you could look at it as just strictly, okay, they saw the three sisters growing in the mound, so that's how we're supposed to farm. But what he's really teaching them is that this path on earth is a temporary one. And we're all headed towards that hole in the ground or the grave. But when we get put into the ground, we will become the energy that feeds that mound, that helps food grow again, that we will all become part of the perpetual regeneration. And this is why then, when you go back and looking at our ceremonies, why they tell us you're just supposed to be buried in a wooden casket. In fact, even drill a hole in it so it'll decay quickly. It will become the earth. But if you put yourself in a concrete crypt or a metal casket, you won't be able to fulfill your destiny after you're walked on the earth. So there's things like that I think are important to reflect on. Well, this is why we do it, because a lot of times our culture is taught to us, just do what I say, don't ask questions. Well, the creation story begs the question. It helps us understand that there's a big reason why this all happened, and it's all an integrated and a comprehensive life plan laid out for us. So by planting the things, harvesting the medicines that Amber talked about, by hunting the animals that were provided for us, but also to end the dysfunction between our relatives so that we can live peacefully. One thing I've noticed, so there's not much humor in the story, is there? Yeah, a little bit.
I think there's moments in it that we could extract out. I mean, I find it terribly amusing on the kind of sense that he knows what's going to happen because the animals are riled up at him. And at the same point, you know, there's moments, I think, for me, there's moments of light humor in there.
Yeah.
You know, but then too, I mean, it's a combustible world,
yeah.
You know, so I think it's, I don't know.
Hewitt was not a funny guy. I mean, he was very serious. He was very meticulous. I don't think that sitting across from him, you know, for hours and hours and hours on end, six words at a time, I don't think I'd have laughed that much. He was a forbidding presence, and he was very definitely and explicitly doing something that white people would go and take seriously because they hadn't. But one of the funny things is if you go digging around some of the archives, like Frederick Waugh, Alexander Goldenweiser, the same people that were Hewitt's informants, I hate that word, but the same people that were talking to Hewitt are talking to Goldenweiser and talking to Waugh, and some of the stuff that they tell him is hysterical. I mean, it's full of, they're joking around, and there's one point where Waugh writes in the corner, "Dirty story, I can never publish this." So I don't think it was that the guys who were sitting around telling these versions of the story didn't have a sense of humor. I can't believe it. I think it has a lot to do with what Hewitt's project was, and this is what we have as the result.
Yeah.
We've got to supply our own chuckles.
Well, I think that goes directly to Hewitt, that because I mean he records the part one versions in the late 1800s, but it's not till 1903 that he publishes it. And I think, doesn't he gather it in 1908, but it's not till 19...
He starts the Gibson version in 1888 or 89, and it's not until 1928
so even
that he
longer.
Publishes it, yeah.
And I read somewhere, I can't remember where I read it right now, but somebody did articulate he was always much more comfortable writing out everything than he was actually publicly speaking.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, that could be part of it.
That also explains why it's taking Kevin so long to publish his dissertation, just following in Hewitt's footsteps. But I would encourage you to speed that up a little bit. Yeah. So with our time that we have left, we've also asked to have some comment on that, and you mentioned Ms. Horn-Miller's dissertation. So we're going to ask her if she could come up here, introduce herself, explain a little bit about her perspective on this, and kind of summarize and react to what you've heard there. We can take about 20 minutes to do that, and then we'll finish up there. But if you could join us here on stage, appreciate it.
Well, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Gahante Horn-Miller. I'm from Gahnawage. I'm an assistant professor at Carleton University in Ottawa. First of all, many thanks. I really enjoyed what you had to say. But as I was listening, I was reflecting back on how I've taken the Sky Woman story, I think, one step further. I mean, in some ways, what you've done is you're bringing it back to life. And I think that's what really is the undercurrent here of what we're talking about, and is how do we bring this story back to life so that it becomes meaningful and it comes off the page for us. So I'd like to explain a little bit about what I've done in terms of doing that kind of thing. So I did my doctoral work in Gahnawage, and I looked at how women in Gahnawage express their identity. And as I was interviewing the women who are ranging in age from early 20s to the late 80s, they talked a lot about Sky Woman as though she was standing with them, next to them, as though she was very much alive in their daily life. And I thought, well, okay, there's something there. I have to revisit the story in order to really get a sense of what it is that that they're talking about and what they mean when they say, well, Sky Woman would have done it this way, and this is what I see, and I think this is how she would have addressed it. And so in looking for the versions and looking at them and trying to figure out, well, what is this story telling me about how these women are reflecting on her life, and how does it speak to them as Ganyatkahaga women? I thought, it doesn't tell me anything. So I had to question why. And I realized that it's because it's, first of all, always written in the third person, and it's written by men. So all of the subtle nuances that are there, that should be there with regards to a woman's perspective on creation, a woman's perspective on the world, a woman's perspective on being a woman, are missing. So what I ended up doing was taking key elements of the story that are in most of the stories and rewriting it in the first person as a way to actively engage with the story and as well, you know, and try to figure out what it is that it tells us about being Ganyatkahaga women. So the way I like to describe this story is that, I use the elements of what these women were telling me in my community to inform the story, because luckily I'm a mother of four daughters and I haven't experienced the death of any of my children. But there are women in my community who have. So the way I see the story is that it's coming back to life because she is in them, in the women, and they are in her. So it's begun this movement of life that happens as we know it in the natural world, right? Life, death, rebirth, life, death, rebirth. It just continues on. So in infusing the story with their lives, and she is in them, it's making that story come back to life again. So in rewriting it, it made me think a lot about my own experiences as a woman, my own life as a woman, as a mother, as a sister, as an auntie, and of course as in with the lives of these women, and it illuminated a lot of things for me about their lives and what they were talking about. And some of these things have come up, things that you're questioning, you know, as you read it on the page. But then again, of course, the living aspect, what does it tell us about our place in the natural world? So these women, that's what it does for them. It's bringing that, all of that, her life is very much in them, and it's bringing all of that back. So now what I've begun doing is performing it. I've taken a part of it, and I'll be sharing that here after this event today over at the Polytechnical High School, or the college. What is it called? Institute, sorry. So it's interesting, in performing the story, I embody her, and it's not hard to do it because we are all her great-granddaughters, Sky Woman's great-granddaughters. So I embody her, and I tell the story in her words. I've infused the story with those missing elements that we find, that we don't find on the written pages, most particularly the birth process, what happens when we give birth and what we do with the placenta afterwards, which we all know many of us bury, and there's good reasons for that. So the response has been that when people see this performance, they feel it. They begin to feel the story. They begin to, as it's performed, it's as though they're stepping inside Sky Woman's world, and they're able to connect better with what she's telling us and the teachings that are in that story. And it's a very interesting, I get a lot of interesting comments, and each time I've performed it, I'm getting more and more insights into how performing our culture, what it does for others who sit around and watch it. And it makes me think about, how did we tell these stories? And that's one of the questions I had as I was listening to you, and I know it came up in your presentation, is how was this story performed or done or told in the past? And I like to think that it was probably performed, because we can't help it. We are an oral people. We are performers. We are diplomats. We are speakers. And we, when we talk, we use ourselves, we use our body, and we use our eyes and our hands and our physical selves to tell these stories, and I think, and to connect with one another. And I think that's probably what went on a long time ago. So this is a way to rekindle that, to bring that back to life, that idea of performing our culture again. So in that, I like to think that we're all looking at the Sky Woman story in different ways. We are all connecting in our own ways. I'm not certain that you're able to connect as a male to the female aspects of the story, but most definitely you are. I can see that in what you talk about. And as well for my own work, I'm able to connect in a very female way to what these dark spaces that are in the story that we don't really are not present in the written versions. So the way I look at it, and this is the way I teach my students, is there's everything in front of you. You might look at the Jesuit relations, you might look at the Sky Woman story, you might look at the Peacemaker's Journey, and what's important is to peel it apart like an onion. That's the way I describe it. You peel apart its many layers, and you look at those hidden spaces and those shadows, those dark shadows, and they tell you something else. But then you draw on what you know as a man, what you know as a woman, from where you come from, your community, your family, your clan, and you draw on what you've learned, just the everyday, and also as being parents, too. Draw on those things and bring those hidden spaces, those dark spaces to life again, and that's what brings these stories back to life. So I I'm not sure what else to comment on, but I think that you know, there's many things about how the story has been interpreted and kind of made flat again through writing it down. And that loss of the invigoration of culture and life into these stories as they've, over the years, as they've been written onto the page. And it's been infused with Catholicism, it's been infused with, you know, the different things that have been going on in the world as we've experienced it, right, with colonization and all of the different harmful things that have happened to our people. And you know, it's interesting to see those things and to question them. And I think that having these kinds of dialogues on bringing these things back to life and taking out those elements and really peeling it apart like an onion is really important and really key as we head into the future. Because really, you know, we're looking at the natural world and we're seeing that it's suffering. So how can we, as a people, draw on what we already have among us and that our ancestors passed down to us, how do we draw on that to find solutions? And I think you have offered some very, very thoughtful and very powerful solutions as well with your own work, you know, rethinking about what is it that's important and that can continue to tell us how we are to act, how we are to behave. Because it's a very rich legacy that we have, and it's important that we continue to talk about these key things and keep them very much alive. So, Yao Goa, thank you for sharing your work.
Would you join us?
Yes.
Thank you for your comments. I appreciate that very much. So as you see, a little bit of time we had together this morning, this big, trying to unpack this big story is going to take a lot more effort, a lot more, but we're here to try to stimulate the conversation. I look very forward to getting their dissertations published, because we need to add the Native voice, the academic Native voice, to this as well. But we also encourage you to go home and talk to some old people and continue the story going, knowing that sometimes you're going to hear inconsistent things or different things, and that's not, we're not here to say whose story is right, but learn as much as you can. And then ultimately, figure out how you're going to apply it into your life. What are the things that you could be doing to help produce this? To help that out, we try to produce a little version of the creation story here at Six Nations Polytechnic with the artwork of Barbara Helen Hill. She did these wool felt paintings that tell different aspects of it. But it was a very difficult challenge, trying to reduce all of this stuff that these folks have studied for years down to a 20-page book is very challenging. But we wanted to get something going. We have it in Onondaga, Cayuga, and Mohawk, because every night I try to read a book or a story to my my daughters when they go to bed. And all of a sudden I realize we're reading all these great books, but very little of the literature comes from our own tradition. So we're trying to reinstitute that. It would be better if we end up being the kind of storytellers. You ask the question, how did storytelling take place a long time ago? And it's true that we had a lot of people who were trained. They had the gift of telling the story. And they would come by the old longhouse, and they would, sometimes they carry this big bag of things. They would reach in there and pull something down. Maybe they'd pull out a bear's tooth. Well, I'll tell you the story of this great monster bear that we're chasing through the sky. Or pull out something else, pull out a turtle shell. Well, I'll tell you the story of the creation. But I also believe what you said is true. They animated the story. And not only is our language so colorful and so descriptive that you're able to remember these things better, but they made this story come alive. And I think that's very important that our speakers need to do that again. But the way it comes alive is you have to have the capacity above. And sometimes when you think about, particularly with our children, they've been so now immersed in everybody else's culture. They're so fascinated by technology and what their iPhone or their iPad tells them. But to find another way to get back to the fact that this is just a way to look at the world. Our ancestors found stories, they found patterns in nature. You know, at one point in the creation story, we talked about the world above. They said this young woman, who eventually became the Sky Woman, or became the woman to kick this off, she was suffering from this grief, from the loss of a loved one. She goes over to meet the old man, and he was suffering this consternation because he was having this deep-seated dream. They became like a medicine for each other. And I think that's a story in itself. But also, maybe because the story was sanitized, that when they slept together, they put their feet together to the bottom of their feet, and they kind of rubbed their toes. And apparently in the sky world, that's all it takes to get pregnant. But I've tried that several times down here, and I tell you, it doesn't work. All you get is cold feet. But anyway, so magic takes place in this story. Certain things happen. We don't need to know it all. Sometimes we just have to take it on faith. That's what happened, and now we have to honor that and find a way to do that. The other time, there's great mystery in the story. There's some things that still perplex me after looking at it for 40 years. I just still can't quite figure it out. But this is one reason why we want to launch this discussion here. So we will continue. We're going to have a whole series then of conversations of cultural fluency. We are going to continue on from here to take a look at our ecological knowledge and what's called the dish with one spoon. At one point in the story, the creator picks up dirt, the earth, and he says, this is alive because through this soil, he made all of these creatures, including ourselves. So we're deeply connected to that. So when you think about, no matter where you walk in North America, the bones of our ancestors have been planted there, and their flesh becomes this soil. So I think he's telling us about that, that this is alive, this is generates life. But he also had the ability to do that by breathing into it, putting a part of his mind and that in there. I was at one workshop where they were talking about the creation story. One of the Native professors suggested that the human dilemma is that even though the Creator put all of this into us, And he wrestled with his brother over about how to do that, his love for his brother caused him to say, I'll tell you what, I'll take over half the mind of the humans, you have the other half. And they will continually wrestle with having to make the decision to do the right thing. I said, boy, this is an interesting dilemma that created for us. But it's also maybe one reason why we get so easily seduced to not do the right thing, to do what we're supposed to do, because Flint, even though he couldn't destroy life in the world, and even though he couldn't bring everything to an end, still has the ability to get us to think negatively. So maybe the unhealthy mind, which is detracting away from that. Hewitt wrote at one time that flint was a mistranslation, he thought, of the actual word, and he thought it had to do more with ice. Because what does ice do when it comes, which we're going to see in a few months? Kills everything it goes, covers the water over, puts a big layer of snow there, can kill growing plants. So we are born into this world of constant regeneration because there's always death coming. We have to accept that. Our death is coming. But if you try to live well before that happens and hopefully enjoy the bounty and the great gifts of nature, then we can live well. One of our old chiefs said one time that we're supposed to live with joy and delight in this world. And sometimes that's hard to find because we've been colonized and we carry a lot of negative legacies. So I think also looking at the creation story, you can see that joy. You can imagine and this stuff being created on purpose for us. All of this great gift, this great bounty, this great reason to live. But we get mired in politics and whatever else goes on in our life. That sometimes we get further and further away from the creation. So this is why our ceremonies are important, because it expresses that thanksgiving. But ultimately, I think the most important thing is doing those things that are suggested in the creation story. It's the act of planting corn. It's the act of harvesting things from nature. It's the act of making good relationships. Because if you don't do that, your ceremony can be a hollow expression of what you should have done. So when we gather together after doing all of these things, it just heightens that. You mentioned children. He did, in one version of the story, talks about that. It's true that women are going to bear children, and they're going to have to suffer in order to do that. And we don't quite understand why. There's a little strange things going on in the creation story as well that still kind of perplex me. But that's the reality of the life that we're given. And that we're supposed to think that the faces of the coming generations are in the soil, slowly moving up to the surface. And then they come out to the woman into this world. So one day I was hunting, and I thought, I'm going to find out if this is true. Put down my gun and took off my hunting belt and my jacket. I looked around, make sure nobody was watching me, and then I start scraping away the leaves. And then you scrape away this year's leaves and next last year's leaves, and down a little further, they're starting to decay. And all of a sudden, you get down to the ground, and I notice it's funny that there was little things crawling there. And you scrape a little further, and all of a sudden, water starts seeping up. Well, I didn't see any faces of babies growing there, but what I saw was life is right there. It's right there under the surface. So when the Creator said, this earth is alive, that's what he meant. But you have to get back in the woods and back in the streams and back in the fields and discover this for yourself. And I believe that our Mother Earth is also a very intuitive teacher. She will teach you this because she wants you to understand that. All of these things that are there for us. So now that it's a harvesting time, and we get out in the fields and pick the bounty that was been offered to us, we'll have ceremonies for that, and eat that great food that they fought about in the sky world, I mean, here in the creation. Now it's all given to us. All we have to do is do it. So with that, I'd like to thank our speakers today. Appreciate your coming all of the way that you did, and we have a few gifts that we're going to give you later. So we're going to go take a lunch break and then join back together at Polytechnic to continue our discussion. But we also like to thank the audience that's here and everybody that's online for joining us. And please stay tuned. We'll have more and more conversations, but we'd like you to participate. So thank you very much. And Yahweh, done it.